Abhishek is a senior delivery leader of technology solutions at Quintiles IMS, a leading multi-channel marketing center of excellence, and he manages client implementations of the Nexus marketing across the globe.
So she did introduce me with some professional things, but you know, I am just a product leader in making, and I'm yet to create my mark in the universe. It's just a process. I just started. So artificial intelligence, you know, we have been dealing, since I started my own education in computer, I have been hearing about AI, but what exactly is AI? AI has been in the industry for more than 70 years now. Imagine if it was a human being, that would be, you know, the end phase of the life. But the best part with the AI is, the older it gets, the more smarter it gets, it becomes. Then, when we think about the AI as a word, you know, a lot of things goes into mind, and it's more like, okay, are we being compared with the machine? Who is more intelligent? So our competitive spirit comes into the picture, and we start thinking, okay, are we really there, or why do we really need artificial intelligence? We don't have enough, or where exactly do we lack? So all these questions keep coming in. Another school of thought is, is AI going to kill our jobs, or is it something which we are going to, you know, is this demon which we are calling here? I would say that, you know, this is something which time is going to tell. It depends how exactly we approach towards it. As you could see in this, the art of fiction, in many of the, you know, in Hollywood they have come up with. So few of the story I will very quickly touch upon, like Robocop. You know, life was already ending there, but using of the biomechs, the person survives and does a quite a good job as a cop. And on the other hand, you would see stealth and the eagle eye. So both of these scenario where the machine overrides human's command and actually makes the decision on behalf of human, saying that the human was incapable of making the right decision for the future. So, 2015, there was a World Health Organization study which say that around 5 crore people in India undergoes depression. And I would say that the reason behind that could be so much of, you know, dependency on social media. Our happiness, our sentiments depends upon the number of likes on our Facebook posts. And it's not very far then, you know, we would depend on machines completely for our emotional support. So, for evil to flourish, you know, good people has to do just nothing. Thankfully, fortunately, we do have few of the leaders who are ensuring that the human beings do exist in future as well. So all these pioneers, everybody knows him, knows here most likely. I would just say one thing. You know, when they talk about the AI, there are few people who will just talk about, you know, if there is something wrong about it or something good. But there are few people who are actually taking action. And these are the few people, every year they collect, come together and in a forum and they discuss. And not just these people, there are topmost AI researchers who come, and few of the Nobel laureates and few of the economists also come and they discuss about the future of AI. And this time when they met in the SLMR conference, so there were around 23 principles which were discussed, related to the issues, related to research, ethics, values, and then how exactly we should shape the future. All these aspects were covered in this conference, and these laws are basically dependent upon, the foundation of these laws goes around like in 1950 when they defined the robotics. So the three things, the first one is, you know, take care of the humanity. Humanity should not be hurt. Then humans should always be saved. And machines should always obey human beings. And the final one, that whenever that robots needs to, you know, survive, and if in case there is ever any conflict, then they should always go to the higher order of the law and follow that instruction. But like you have seen in the iRobot, that principles were not really followed. That's the reason there was a very high need to ensure that these principles are formulated and people do follow them. So now, once we set up such principles, what exactly happens? So that is the foundation to have a smart and safe city developed, and everything could get connected. And all this is only going to happen because of internet and because of the artificial intelligence. Now, why this it took around 70 years to reach there? What were the top things which really push the artificial intelligence to be where it is right now? So the very first thing, Internet of Things. You know, Facebook launched their drones, Aquila, Google came up with their own project, Google Loop, and all these projects were to ensure that internet reaches to every household in the world. And though they partially succeeded, they are still work in progress, but I am more excited to know that Elon Musk, he is coming up with an idea of launching 4,500 satellites which will cover the entire globe. Imagine getting internet at every house, every nook and corner of the earth. Second, now we have the cloud computing as the greatest infrastructure. So the amount of information which can be stored and the computing speed that has grown up exponentially. By since 2010, it has grown up by 50%. So that's a huge amount. And the third thing is big data. So when we talk about big data, it's basically a collection of various data sets at the very high level with high level of complexity. And the three things to notice on this particular, on big data is about volume, variety, and velocity. If you think about 745 million, if you think about the tweets, so if the whole world, the population in the whole world, they start tweeting, if they tweet three tweets per minute for 745 years, that's the amount of volume of data we are dealing with. Then variety, the data is could be from people to people, could be from people to machine, and from machine to machine. And the velocity, you can see that 500 million tweets are tweeted per day, and 204 million emails per minute is sent. And the searches is around 3.5 billion search in Google. So with this huge data, we definitely needed cloud infrastructure which can support it. So what exactly, where exactly AI comes into the picture? There are a lot of things people talk about. They talk about machine learning, they talk about the expert systems, they do talk about the computer, the visual part of it, even augmented reality is also considered here. Then NLPs. So I would give one example here on the NLP. There are a lot of industries which are using natural language processing to really overcome the challenges of identifying what are the threats coming on onto the internet, or if you relate it to the healthcare industry, let's say if there's a company or a pharma company, and if they come up with some drug and they want to see how exactly people are feeling about that drug, and that has been posted on a website, in any of the social media channels, these artificial intelligence or machine learning part, they go through each and every comments on a Facebook page, and they can analyze depending upon some sort of an ontology which is describing whether the trend is going positive towards the company or it's going negative. Now, few of the examples which I've taken here in the artificial intelligence, what the actual application, if you see, these are basically NLP based, and then the voice recognition. So if Apple has come up with Siri, and Windows has come up with Cortana, and Google is omnipresent, then Amazon has come up with Alexa. Alexa is also first, it's more like a human being, it behaves and talks like a human being. And you could even place an order, you could adjust a lot of, for example, you can turn on the TV using Alexa, just by using voice command. Then OpenAI is one of the very interesting thing, I would say. Elon Musk, this is his company, he has come up with an AI research company. So a lot of AI projects are being researched here to ensure that we are doing proper deep dive into the projects and doing proper analysis whether it is going to be feasible in a long run or not. Automated vehicles. So in this has been in existence actually since 1920, but the level of automation has continuously been growing. In 1920, it was more of a radio control, and it was used in US to see how exactly the car can perform. And few will debate that, you know, Tesla is not truly the one who has come up with automation. There have been many. And yeah, I do agree. Even Google has some automation done on the cars. But still, it's my favorite, so I just wanted to put it there. And they have been, actually, the maximum number of automation cars on the road is from Tesla. Now, if you see the theory of evolution of how exactly the predictive analytics has evolved, so there are still, even in today's day, there are many companies who are still on the very basic and, you know, on a reactive mode. Then few companies started using the little bit of understanding that, okay, last year this was the sale, so they used that as a parameter to judge what is going to be the future, what should we predict. After that, they started using spreadsheets and then the statistical analysis, and afterwards they again moved forward, and now there are many companies who have started using the next level of the information using the, you know, from machine learning. And since there is a lot of big data and AI is used combined together, they are able to drive 90% of accurate predictions for what exactly future is going to be. So now, this is truly the big picture which I want to talk about. If you see how exactly AI is growing, yeah, people definitely get scared. And a lot of people may think that whether we will have a job or not. So if we talk about machine learning, it has the potential to grow to $70 billion by the year 2020. If we talk about the industrial robotics, China takes care of the 25% of the whole world. And by next year, 2018, they are going to take up 38% of the whole market share in industrial robotics. Then the automobile and transportation, around 1.9 trillion automation revenue is expected by 2025, thanks to the autonomous cars. Aerospace and defense, the investment from 2010 to 2016 has grown up by 16%. Finance is one of the area where I've seen and observed the growth is going to be huge. It's more than exponential, I would say. From 225 billion in 2008 to 2.2 trillion is expected to be by 2020. In healthcare, now we also have care bots which has come up. So in year 2000, there were around 1,000 surgeries which happened in robotics. And by 2014, we already touched 570,000 surgeries where robotics were used. Then in the service segment, approximately 90 to 115 billion hours are spent. If you calculate in the dollar value, it's approximately $300 to $500 billion per year is spent on that. So with care bots, we will have plenty of time to focus on doing something different, something else. In agriculture, around $16.3 billion is the expected market by 2020. So with all these, you know, the big staggering figures, numbers, we do think that, okay, where exactly are we heading? If we are not part of the AI, aren't we missing something? And this has been the key question, whether we will have a job in future or not. So there are different school of thoughts, and the way I have looked on it is, jobs will always be there. You know, the same statement was given earlier also when computer was coming into the industry, that, you know, everybody will lose job, everything will be done by computers. But with AI, jobs will be there. It's just that we need to adapt, we need to change. And we may have to learn how better to control the robots, maybe. Another figure from the enterprise segment, I would say, and a lot of entrepreneurs do say that if we are using AI, it makes our data more meaningful and it helps us get to the right problem. It helps to solve the right problem. And Harvard Business Review, in one of their articles, they mentioned that if they're, 82% of common people thinks that this is, that they are going to definitely suffer and they are going to lose jobs. Now, change is inevitable. That is for sure. We all understand that. But what we can do best is adapt so we can really make big in the industry. Thank you.
Abhishek, I think you could have done a much nicer job on the topic. I think the topic was extremely attractive for a lot of audience. And again, I go back to the audience. Right? You could have taken two approaches, I guess. One is go deep, you know, more technical depth, etc., etc. The other one is go horizontal, which is as if you're explaining to somebody who doesn't understand anything about the subject. Right? They are for the first time getting exposed to this topic. So when you started with, for example, I'll just take one example. We started with the history 70 years ago. It would have been a very nice timeline that showed what happened in the last 70 years around the topic of artificial intelligence. And how did that discussion progress in that timeline? And where did we land today? Right? And what are some of the topics which could have come up around that time? So I think you were trying to do too much. You lost me when you went to big data and you kind of jumped around to something else. It almost seemed, again, I don't know how, you know, what your thought process was when you put the slides together. It almost seemed to me you were fitting a story to the slides rather than a slide to a story. I'm not sure which approach you took, but what I would encourage is, you know, if you're putting a story together and it's true for everybody, what I like to do, this is what I do personally, is I actually write it out long form as a document. And then because the document allows you to tell its story in its completeness, and then you say, okay, which pieces of this should I make it attractive for the audience? And hence build a storyline around it. And to me, a PowerPoint slide is just a final outcome which you absolutely need if you need it for the audience. In some cases, you can do this talk without any slides and make it quite powerful. So I think those are the styles you need to work with to try to understand how you want to do this, you know, going forward. So mine would be a six. Just because of the fact that, you know, you seem to stray around in terms of what you want to say.
Thank you, Professor Ram. I think the audience should also be making notes. This is an advanced presentation class, if any. Today is the day you're getting a lot of insight from the jury. Now, Professor Rahul, if you could share your feedback.
So, yeah, I agree with Ram. This was a topic that could have gone a lot better in a lot, many different ways. And in some sense, this topic, what Professor Amin talked about, right, this is this whole new world with AI. And how do you make us want to be part of that world? And I think that opportunity you missed, and you had that opportunity with this topic especially. Right? And I'm saying this kind of, you know, generally for everybody, that when you stand up to speak on a particular topic, you select a topic, you know, why are you the best person to talk about this topic? Right? Either you have some credibility in this area that we should all listen to you, right, or you have some interesting perspective to share. Right? So, you know, we almost have to build curiosity before we dump content on people. Right? And I think that, you know, I would encourage you, and this is kind of a general comment for everybody. Right? Yeah, and so when we put stuff on a slide, and lots of data points, lots of things, and lots of information, you know, one question to ask is, so what? Who cares? What does it mean? And so I think you take it a little bit deeper and try and answer that question and be ruthless about eliminating stuff on your slides. So I'll also give you a six. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ravi. Professor Vasudev Murthy.
So my first question to you is, have you read Isaac Asimov? You're not read.
I read the principles, though.
Principles, but he read in about 100, 200 books. So, you know, taking on what they were saying, I think wonderful data, wonderful presentation, etc. But again, it's overwhelming, and I would have loved to see a story evolve rather than, you know, frankly, overwhelmed with data. So, if you read Isaac Asimov's stories, for example, I think that would have been much more of crystal ball gazing and creating a vision of what would life be like in 2020, and all these things could have been weaved together rather than this looks like corporate presentation. Very well done graphically, all that is very, very nice. I mean, I think. You could, but again, the lack of developed, shall we say, a sense of stories, how to write a story, how to read, if you read him, I think that's where the real wonders would have happened. Otherwise, to be honest, this looks like a very good corporate presentation. It's not yet giving me that kick I'm looking for. I really want a vision, okay? But I'll be a little more generous because I kind of liked, at least you knew who Isaac Asimov was. I don't know how many people know that. So that's good. So I would like to give you a
thank you, sir.